In the last few lectures, we had seen how we can implement adders and multipliers. In this lecture, we shall be looking at the design of dividers, the various algorithms which you can use and how we can implement them in hardware. Okay? So, the topic of our discussion today is design of dividers. Before we start, let us look into a basic problem that is there in the division operation, because the first thing is that division is more complex than multiplication because of various reasons that we shall be seeing during the course of this lecture. Now, to appreciate this point that division is indeed more difficult than multiplication or any other arithmetic operation, let us look at some typical facts and figures which are present in one of the commercial processors of the yesteryear, Pentium 3. So, here in a table we are showing for some typical instructions or arithmetic operations two things. One is called the latency, other is called the cycles per issue. Shall be coming back to this. So just one thing we can see from this table, that the values for divide operations, either integer or floating point whatever, is much higher as compared to the values for load, store, multiply, addition, this kind of operations. Okay? Now, these are the values for Pentium 3, and even in the very recent processors, the relative differences, they still remain. So, we shall be coming back to this slide once more. First, let us see what do we mean by latency and cycles per issue. Let us look at this first. Latency refers to the minimum delay starting from the time when the first set of input is applied and up to which the first result is obtained. So, latency talks about the just the initial delay, the delay for the first time. Suppose I have a circuit, it can be an adder, it can be a multiplier, divider, whatever. I apply a set of inputs. Now, the question is, after how much time I get my result? This time duration is called latency. So, minimum after how much time I can get back my first result. Now, there is another thing. Well, you see, I apply an input, I get back an output after some time, that is equal to the latency. Now, the second point is that how frequently can I apply the inputs? Do I have to wait until the operation is complete before I apply the second input, or I can overlap my operation in some way? Well, if I have to wait for the operation to be complete before I apply the next input, then the so called cycles per issue, this is called cycles per issue, after minimum how much gap I can apply my second input, that will be the same as latency. But if we are allowed to have some kind of an overlap, means before the first operation is complete, I am allowed to feed in the next input or the next to next input. This is what happens in a typical pipeline processor, which we shall be looking into detail much later during the course of these lectures. Now, in a pipeline implementation, we can apply inputs much faster, although the latency value remains basically the same. I apply one input, after how much time the result comes out, that remains same. But the inputs that I apply one after the other, the gaps between them, that can be less. So, the second point or parameter here is cycles per issue. So, let us try to explain this. So, whenever we apply a new set of inputs to some functional unit like an adder or a multiplier, we call it an issue, that the inputs have been issued. Now, as I have said, that if we have pipelined implementation, then we can reduce the number of clock cycles between successive issues. But for a circuit like divider, it is very difficult to have a pipeline implementation. Most of the dividers are non-pipelined. So for such circuits, the number of clock cycles between successive issues is much higher. Next input can be applied only after the previous operation is complete. So let us go back to the previous slide and see. For load store kind of instructions, latency is 3 clock cycles, while cycles per issue is 1. That means I can issue one such instruction every clock cycle. There is an overlap possible. For integer multiply, again latency is 4, so I can complete multiplication in 4 cycles, but I can apply new sets of inputs every 1 clock cycle. Floating point addition, again 3 is the latency, 1 is the clock cycles per issue, and for floating point multiply it is 5 and 2. But you see, for divide, latency and cycles per issue values are same, 36 here, and for floating point 38. This means that division units are not pipelined. They actually work as a single non-pipelined block. You apply an input, get the output. After it is finished, only then you apply the second input. Okay? So cycles per issue is equal to the latency. Okay. Let us now look into the process of integer division. So what do we really do when we divide two numbers? So for integer division, we have something called a divisor, something called a dividend. We divide the dividend by the divisor. D is greater than m. So the objective is to find a quotient, that is the result of the division, and of course a remainder. Remainder r should be less than this divisor m, and this m, d, q and r, they are related by an equation like this: quotient multiplied by the divisor plus the remainder will give you the dividend. Okay, fine. Now just if we ignore the remainder for the time being, d is q multiplied by m. So you see, there are basically two things which you are multiplying and you get back d. So there is an analogy you can draw between division and multiplication. The operations look quite similar. So here we are talking about dividend, quotient and divisor, and in multiplication we talked about product, multiplicand and multiplier. So there is a correspondence between dividend and product, quotient and multiplicand, divisor and multiplier. Now this correspondence will be clear when we look at the basic data path or the circuit that we use for division, and if you compare the circuit with what we had used for multiplication, you can see that see this correspondence immediately. Okay, fine. So because of this correspondence, very similar circuits and very similar kinds of algorithms can be used for multiplication as well as division. So let us just work out a simple example division using the traditional approach, which is sequential digit by digit shift and add kind of thing. So which is quite similar to what we do using the so called pencil and paper approach. So the example we take is for a dividend d which is 37, in decimal it is 100101, divisor is 6110, we are dividing d by m. So d we are writing here, this is 37100101, and this is my divisor 110, which is 6. So what we do in a normal division step, we see if my divisor goes with the first 3 digit here, it is 100. So if it goes, I can subtract, right? But here we see that 110 is greater than 100, which means it does not go. Because it does not go, what we do? We set the next quotient bit to 0 if it does not go. So, the next quotient bit is set as 0. So, this is one step. So, because it does not go, we do not make any change to the dividend, it remains the same. Okay? Next step, the divisor we shift by one place and repeat the same process. We shift right by one step and we compare it with this 1001. Now we see 1001 is greater than this, that means we can subtract, which means it does go and the next quotient bit will be 1. So, because it goes, now we can do the actual subtraction. 1 minus 0 is 1, this is 1, this is 0, that is it. So, you repeat the same process, divisor again you shift by another position and again check. 110110, again it goes. So, next quotient bit is also equal to 1. So, again you subtract 000 and this 1 remains. Last step, the quotient is shift, this divisor is shifted again one place and again you check, but here it does not go because 001 is smaller. So, it does not go. So, the next quotient bit is 0. So, I do not make any change. So, what it finally remains here, this will be my remainder and I have already found out my quotient. So, my quotient is 6 in decimal, my remainder is 1 in decimal. So, you see here the steps which I have shown side by side. So, the quotient bit that we are generating, for example, q 1 equal to 1 and this divisor m, I am shifting it right by one position. I am expressing it as 2 to the power minus 1 into m. 2 to the power minus 1 means divide by 2 and you recall divide by 2 means shifting the number right by one position. Okay. So, we are doing exactly that here. Similarly, here we are shifting m right by 2 positions, 2 to the power minus 2 means dividing by 4. Here we are shifting it right by 3 positions, 2 to the power minus 3 into m. So, actually whatever we are trying to subtract, it is actually the quotient bit multiplied by 2 to the power some minus I into m. This partial remainders, you can say R1, starting with R0, R1, R2, R3 and finally R4 you get, we subtract these values from this RIs. Okay? This is what we do here. Right? Now, so just to recall exactly what we saw. So, we were computing the bits of the quotient one at a time and at each step what you are doing, the divisor was being shifted I bits to the right. You see here it was 1 bit, 2 bits, 3 bits. So, I goes from 1, 2, 3, 2 to the power minus 1, minus 2, minus 3 like this. So, we shift I bits to the right, that means we compute 2 to the power minus I into m and is compared with the current partial remainder whether it goes. If it goes, then we set q I equal to 1. If it does not go, we set q I equal to 0. Right? And the new partial remainder is computed by subtracting. So, if it does not go, q i is 0. So, actually this is 0 anyway. So, we do not make any change, r I minus 0. But if it is 1, we subtract the shifted divisor 2 to the power minus a m from r I, right? This is what we do. But in the actual machine implementation, if we want to implement by hardware, just like in multiplication algorithm, we were keeping the partial product shifted and the multiplicand we are keeping in the same position. We are following the same principle here. The partial remainders we shall be shifting, but the divisor will be keeping fixed in one position. That will help us in implementing it in hardware. So, here it is more convenient to shift the partial remainder to the left, but we keep the divisor in a fixed location, which means in the earlier case we are doing something like this, right? We were shifting the divisor to the right and we are subtracting from the partial remainder. but now we shall be shifting the partial remainder to the left, that means multiplying by 2, twice ri, and we will be subtracting this divisor which is at a fixed location. So there is no 2 to the power minus I here, just qi multiplied by m. If the next quotient bit is 0, we do not subtract anything. If it is 1, we subtract the divisor. But here the only one change is that because we are not shifting this, the final partial remainder that remains, actually to get the remainder from there, the final remainder, we have to shift it right by 3 places. This is the only correction or the note we have to make. So here we have an example worked out, that same example, 37/6. Here you see 37 is the dividend, here we express it in 6 bits, and divisor we see that whether it goes 110. Divisor is in fixed place, you see 110 is in fixed place. So it does not go. So we set the next quotient bit to 0 and no subtraction. So the partial remainder remains the same, this is R1. We shift R1 to the left by one position, shift left. So this becomes 100101 and a 0 goes in. Now you again try to subtract 110 from here. Here it goes. So the next quotient bit will be 1. You do an actual subtraction, 1, 1 and 0, and these 3 bits remain. This is my second partial remainder R2. Shift it left again, twice R2. So again you subtract the divisor, it again goes 110, 110. So next quotient bit is again 1. So you subtract, this is R3, shift it left, divisor, try to subtract, you see that it does not go. So next quotient bit is 0 and you do not subtract, and whatever was there, it remains. So remainder is this. So remainder, actually to get the remainder, you will have to shift it right by 3 positions. That was actually mentioned here. Remainder multiplied by 2 to the power 3 is actually what you are getting here. So this will be my quotient and this will be my remainder. So one thing you have seen from this example is that at every step, we are checking whether the divisor goes, that means whether we can subtract it or not. But in an actual hardware circuit, how we shall check that, whether it goes or does not go? We can do it by making a trial subtraction. Let us do a subtraction and see that the result is becoming negative or not. If the result is becoming negative, then you can say that it does not go. If the result remains positive, then it's fine, because we are talking about unsigned numbers, no negative numbers so far. Okay. But if you find it does not go and you have already subtracted, so we will have to add the divisor back to restore the correction, restore the original value. So a restoring step may be required, okay, as the correction. So here, as I said, we do not subtract here, we do not subtract here, these 2 places. And the concept that we are saying, that we make a trial subtraction and then we can add it back to make the correction step when we see that it does not go, that can be very easily implemented by using a hardware circuit or a data path, as we can see in this diagram. So this diagram looks very much similar to the multiply data path, that is why we said that there is a very strong correspondence. So we have a temporary register A, which will be initializing to 0. The dividend we store here and the divisor we store in another register. And this A is a, this is an n plus 1 bit register, one extra bit, because we have to check the sign after trial subtraction. So what we do from A, at every step we do a trial subtraction of the divisor. We do a subtraction and check whether the result of the subtraction, that means the sign bit, is 0 or 1. So the control unit will be checking that. So if it sees that the result is negative, then it will again activate an addition step. So the divisor will be added back to A to restore back the value. That means I have done a subtraction wrongly, I add it back to restore the previous value. This is basically what we are trying to do. And this whole process we repeat, and in every step we shift dividend and this A register left by one position. This was exactly what we are doing here, right? We are shifting this every step by one position, one position, one position. We do exactly the same thing here, right, in hardware. So in terms of the steps, so we have this A register, Q register and the divisor in another register M. So we shift the dividend one bit at a time into register A. So both A and Q we are shifting left. Subtract divisor M from A, that means M is aligned to A. We always subtract M from A. This is a trial subtraction. If the result is negative, which means it is not going, then we add M back to register A. This is the restoring step. And because it was not going, the next quotient bit, that means last bit of Q, we record as 0. But if the result is positive, that means it goes, you do not do any restoration or addition and record 1 as the next quotient bit. Okay? This can be depicted in the flowchart form as follows. The same thing which you said, this you see, we load A with 0, M contains the divisor, Q contains the dividend. So we start by shifting left AQ, that means the first bit of the dividend gets into A and we make a trial subtraction. This is your trial subtraction. After shifting, you make a trial subtraction. Then you check after trial subtraction whether A is becoming negative or not. If you say A is negative, which means it does not go, in that case the last bit of Q0 you set to 0 and you add M back to A. This is a restoration step. But if you see A is not negative, A is positive after subtraction, then it is fine. You simply set the quotient bit to 1 and repeat this n times. Count was initialized to n, decrement by 1. As long as it does not reach 0, you repeat this loop. If it reaches 0, you stop, right. This is the basic restoration division algorithm. Now you see from this flowchart that you are looping n times. Now every time you are starting by doing a subtraction, and depending on the sign of A, negative or positive, you are either doing an addition or not doing an addition. So we can say that on the average, we shall be doing the corrective addition 50% of the time, okay? That means n by 2 time on the average. So this is the analysis. So for n bit divisor and n bit dividend, we iterate n times. So every time we carry out a trial subtraction, that means there are n trial subtraction, and on the average number of restoring additions will be n by 2, because in the best case you will not need any restoration, 0, worst case it will be n. So average will be n plus 0 by 2, n by 2. Okay. So the total number of addition subtraction will be n plus n by 2 here. Okay. There is an example which is worked out here. I shall actually just work out this example on paper just to show. So I am illustrating the steps here. The same example I shall be working out. Finally, you get the remainder and quotient. Let us work out this example. So we want to carry out a division operation, 8 divided by 3, right. So what you do, we start like this. We have this A register. A is a n plus 1 bit register. Suppose we are representing everything in 4 bits. So A will be a 5 bit register, initialized to 0. And side by side there is a Q register. Q will contain the dividend 8, 1, 0, 0, 0. And the multiplicand here m is 3. So, m in binary is 0, 0, 1, 1. So, you start the operation. So, you will have to make a trial subtraction from A, first step. So, you subtract 0, 0, 1, 1 from A. This is a subtraction you are doing. So, after subtraction, if you do a subtraction, the result will be 1, 1, 1, 1, 0. So, what you see after subtraction is that your result is negative. That means your sign bit is 1. Because your sign bit is 1, you will have to restore it back. That means you add 0, 0, 1, 1 again to restore back the original value. Of course, means one thing I just missed out. So, you have to start by making a shifting. So, you first make a shift and then do this addition. So, this will be a shift 0, 0, 0 dash and then you do the addition subtraction. So, this 0, 0, 0, 0, 1 minus this will be this. Okay. Now, it is correct. So, if you do a restoration, it will become 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. That means, you get it back. This is your restore step. Because you are restoring, what will happen is that this was your content of A and the Q content, this bit will be 0. So, the quotient bit will also become 0 because this bit is 1. This 1 will result in this bit also being 0. That means, it is not going and this is your first step or the first cycle, you can say cycle 1. So, you repeat this. So, you repeat the same process. So, you shift it again left by one position. So, it becomes 0, 0, 0, 1, 0. This will be 0, sorry, this will be 0. So, this will be 0, 0, 0 dash. So, again you check whether this 0, 0, 1, 1 is going or not. So, you make a trial subtraction again 0, 0, 1, 1. So, if you do a subtraction, the result will be 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. So, here again you see that your sign bit is 1. That means, it is not going. So, you restore it back. Restore 0, 0, 1, 1, add it again. You get back 0, 0, 0, 1, 0. And here 0, 0, 0 was there. This last bit also will get 0 because this was also not going. Because of this one, this bit will be 0. And this will be your cycle 2. This we will have to repeat 4 times. In the third cycle, you continue the same process, again shift it left 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, this is 0. You make a trial subtraction minus 0, 0, 1, 1. Now it goes 1, 0, 0 is greater than 0, 0, 1, 1. So, this trial subtraction if you make, the result will be 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. So, now the sign bit is 0. That means, it goes. So, you do not need any restoring addition here. So, what you do? You simply this bit you fill up with 1 because it is going. Okay. The quotient bit has to be because of this 0, this bit will become 1. This will be your cycle 3. And the last cycle, you again shift it left 0, 0, 0, 1, 0. You shift it left, this will become 0, 0, 1 dash. Again, do a trial subtraction minus 0, 0, 1, 1. If you do a subtraction, it will be 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. You see?
Mm-hmm.
So here again, the result is becoming negative. It does not go. Right? So you will have to do a restoration. 0, 0, 1, 1, add it back. So you get 0, 0, 0, 1, 0 back. And the last bit will become 0 again. So, this bit is 0 and this one determines it. So, you see, this is your cycle number 4. So, you have finished 4 cycles and at the end of 4 cycles, you get your remainder here and you get your quotient here. 2 and 2, 8 divided by 3 generates a remainder of 3 and a quotient also, remainder of 2 and a quotient of 2, right. So, this is how you can work out the algorithm step by step by hand. Okay. Let us look into an improvement now. Now, the restoration division algorithm that you have talked about, here what you have seen is that we are doing subtraction every time in the iteration and on the average half a time we are also doing a corrective addition. Now, let us see if you can reduce the number of addition and subtraction. Our objective is to carry out only one operation every iteration. Total addition subtraction will be n only. Okay? So, we make an observation. We observe that in the restoring division algorithm that you have already seen, what you are doing is, if means after the trial subtraction A was positive, we shift it left and subtract M. That means, shift left means we are doing 2A, then we are subtracting M. Shift left means multiplying by 2. But if A was negative, what we are doing? We were first restoring it by adding back M, A plus M, then shifting and then again subtracting M. Subtracting M for the next iteration. So, this was done in the current iteration and again you go back next iteration, you again do a subtract. So, if you combine the two, what it means is that this A plus M is done, shift it left means twice of that, then subtract M minus M. So, this is 2A plus M. So, effectively in one case you are doing 2A minus M and in the other case you are doing 2A plus M. So, if we can modify our algorithm by making this observation, then we can reduce the number of operations. This method is called non-restoring division. So, let us see what we do here. We similarly start by initializing register A to 0 and repeat these steps B, C and D n number of times. The method is simple. If A is positive, you shift A and Q left by one position and subtract M from A. But if it is negative, you add M to A. This was the observation. Okay? In one case, we subtract M, other case, you add M. Then you check if after this addition or subtraction, A is positive or negative. If it is positive, set the quotient bit to 1, else set the quotient bit to 0. Now, see here we are including one additional subtraction which is there in the next iteration with this operation. So, for the last time there may be an addition subtraction operation which we have carried out. So, we may have to carry out a corrective addition only at the very end. Okay? So, that we are doing here. If at the very end A is negative, that means we have carried out a wrong last subtraction, we have to make a corrective addition at the end, right. So, in terms of flowchart, so whatever we just wrote here, we are just showing it diagrammatically like this. We initialize the registers as earlier, we check A is negative or not. If yes, we shift left and add. If no, shift left and subtract. Then we check whether A is still negative or positive. If it is negative, the quotient bit is set to 0 or quotient bit is set to 1. This thing you repeat n times, and after you complete n times, you check finally whether A is still negative or not. If it is still negative, you have a corrective addition step. Okay, this is what the algorithm is. So here again I shall be working out this simple example 8 by 3 by hand. So the same example I will be taking, I am just showing this animation first. Fine. So let us work this out again. So here just exactly similar to what we did for the restoring division, we start with this register A containing all zeros and register Q containing the dividend. And you recall our divisor was 3, which was 0011. This was M. So according to the algorithm, let us go back to the algorithm. We shall be just looking into it. We are starting with by checking whether A is negative or not. Accordingly, we do a shift and then addition or subtraction. So we are doing that same thing. So we are seeing that the number is positive. So we will be doing a shifting and then a subtraction. If you do a shifting, this becomes 0, 0, 0, 0. This 1 comes here. This will be 0, 0, 0 dash. This is your shifting. Then you do a subtraction, subtract m from this, minus 0, 0, 1, 1. So the result will be 1, 1, 1, 1, 0. And this 0, 0, 0, you see, after subtraction, your sign is 1. So your next bit here will be 0. So this one will decide the next quotient bit 0. You see the flowchart once more, that here we do a subtraction, and after subtraction we check whether A is negative or not. Well, if it is negative, we set Q0 to 0. Exactly that is what we are doing. So because it is negative, we are setting Q0 to 0. So let us continue with this. So we have a shift step, we have a subtract step. This is your cycle 1. So you repeat this step, shift left again one position. Now this is 1, okay. That is why you have to shift and add. If it is 0, we will be subtracting, if it is 1, we will be adding. So we do a shift first, it will be 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, this 0 will come in, 0, 0, 0 dash, and we will be doing an addition here, plus 0, 0, 1, 1. So this will be 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, and 0, 0, 0. See here again, you see that the sign is 1. So the next bit that will be coming in the quotient will be 0, just like in the previous case. This 1 will be deciding this quotient bit, and this is your cycle 2. So in cycle 2, we have done a shift, we have done an add. Now this is plus. So again we will have to do an add, shift and add. If it is 0, we will do a minus. If it is a 1, we will do a plus. So first again shift left. So it will be 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0 dash. This is shift. Then add 0, 0, 1, 1. So after adding, we will be getting 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. And the next quotient bit will be 1 because the sign bit is now 0. So if the sign bit is 1, quotient will be 0. If it is 0, it will be 1. So we are doing a shift and then we are doing an add. This is your cycle 3. And in the last cycle, you again continue with the same thing. This is 0. So now you'll be doing a shifting and then subtracting because it is 0. So we do a shift first. 0, 0, 0, 1, 0. This will also be shifted. 0, 0, 1, dash. Now we'll be doing a subtraction. Minus 0, 0, 1, 1. So if you do this subtraction, this will be become one, all 1s. And because it is 1, this bit will become 0. So again, this is 1. This 1 will decide this is becoming 0. So we have completed 4 cycles, right? So in the last cycle, we have done a shift and we have done a subtract. So after completing 4 cycles, we see that our sine bit of A is still 1, which means we need that correction step. So 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, we need to have a corrective addition step. We add this 1, 1 to this. If you add this, you will be getting 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, which will be your final remainder. This will be your remainder, and already whatever is there in the Q register, this will be your quotient 2 and 2. So, you see, step by step, we have seen how the restoring division algorithm works. So, regarding the data path is exactly identical to what we saw for the restoring algorithm. So, there is no difference. The same hardware can be used, only your control unit will be different. The advantage is that we need only n number of addition or subtraction steps here, right? Now, just one thing, means if we want to go for high speed division, some of the methods that we have already seen to design high speed multipliers can be used here also, like we can use high speed adders and subtractors using carry lookahead adders, carry select adders, etc. We can use high speed shifters like barrel shifters. We can use combinational array dividers, which are similar to combinational array multipliers, and they means actually can implement the restoring division algorithm. But the problem with division algorithm is that you can do it, but it is extremely uneconomical and means ineffective to build a combinational array kind of a divider vis-a-vis what we could do for a multiplier for multiplying two numbers using carry save adders. The other thing is that including sign in the division process, that means signed division algorithm, is not easy. Normally, it is done using a separate step by separately checking the sign bits and making a corrective step at the end to correct the sign of the product or the divisor, the remainder and the quotient. So, sign division is again a problem. So, the main difficulty that we have seen earlier in the very beginning of the lecture, we said that for division, the latency as well as the number of cycles per issue are very high. That is mainly because of the difficulty in implementing the division algorithm in a pipeline. Multiplication can be very effectively implemented in a pipeline in a Wallace tree kind of a multiplier. That is why you have seen that the number of cycles per issue can be for multiplications can be as low as 1. Every cycle you can feed a new data to a multiplier, and the total latency will be 3. It takes 3 cycles to complete the multiplication, but for division it is not so. Division still remains the bottleneck. So, as a programmer, whenever you are developing some applications or programs, you should keep this in mind. Division is an expensive operation. You should replace division by by other arithmetic operations wherever possible. Okay, that can increase the effectiveness of your program or application in terms of the speed and performance. So, in the next lectures, we shall be moving on to firstly the floating point operations. So, how we can extend whatever we have learned so far to handle floating point numbers, numbers with decimal points. And secondly, we shall be looking at other logical operations, how everything can be integrated within the arithmetic logic unit. So, we come to the end of this lecture. Thank you.